Oh, have such a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold on firmly to our confession. Certainly we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our infirmities, but one who has been taught by trial in all things, just as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace for assistance in time of need. Every high priest is selected from among men and is appointed for their sake in matters pertaining to God, so that he may offer both gifts and sacrifice for their sins. The high priest can deal gently with those who are ignorant and going astray, since he himself is also subject to weakness. Because of this, he must offer sacrifice for the sins of the people, as well as for himself. Moreover, nobody assumes their honor by himself, but one is called by God, just as Aaron was. Likewise, Christ did not glorify himself to be made a high priest, but it was God who said to him, "You are my son, today I have become your father." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek."
Peace be with you, the reader.
Remember,
Adam and Eve were expelled from the garden with the words, lest they eat from the tree of eternal life also. Now that they've eaten from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, lest they eat also that other tree and become like us. That's the verse in the very, very, very beginning. What does it mean? That means that now that they've tasted of disobedience and sin, they can no longer eat from this other tree, which is the tree of life. That's why we're going to put them out of the garden. However, that tree of life, was displayed in the Old Testament, in the prophets, in many, many, many cases. Saint Gregory Palamas, whose link to his homily I put in the email, I don't know if anyone clicks on these things, but he speaks very, very profoundly of the cross. He says, the cross was displayed even with Moses, when he stretched out his hands and stopped the advance of the invading forces, when he stretched out his hands and parted the Red Sea, displayed when he put the snake on top of the wood, forming a cross, and everyone who looked up on that snake on the wood were delivered from the plague that was going on in the camp of the Israelites, forming the cross. But the cross is also displayed in the prophets' own lives. Saint Gregory goes to say it was displayed with Abraham when he agreed to follow what God asked of him. God said, get up and leave this land. Leave this land, and I will show you a land where you're going to go. And we know that he was all the way from probably today's Iran or Iraq, from those lands. And he left all his family. He left all his family and went all the way, journeyed, to come to Palestine. Today we call Palestine. And St. Gregory says that denial of himself, of being with his family, being in his own land, already in practice displays the cross. When you deny yourself and you follow Christ, it's a cross. Going further, his son Isaac, who was going to be sacrificed, displays the cross, especially the ram that was in that bush, entangled. And St. Gregory says that the place was called the place of forgiveness, even more, speaking of how the cross and its power can save. Going forward, all the prophets really and all the righteous people carried the cross in their life. Even before the cross was presented and Jesus was lifted up on it in glory. I'll read you just a few paragraphs from that sermon. Surely we should honor and use the divine trophy of the freedom of the whole human race. Its appearance alone puts the serpent, the originator of evil, to flight, triumphs over him and disgraces him, proclaiming him defeated and crushed. It glorifies and magnifies Christ and displays his victory to the world. If it were really necessary to disregard the cross because Christ suffered death on it, then his death too would be neither honorable nor glorious. So how can we have been baptized into his death, as the apostle tells us in Romans 6:3, How can we share in his resurrection if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death? On the other hand, if someone were to reverence the sign of the cross without the Lord's name written upon it, he could justly be accused of doing something incorrect. Since at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in the earth and things under the earth, and the cross bears this venerable name. How very foolish not to bow the knee at Christ's cross. Inclining our hearts as well as bending our knees, come, let us worship with David the psalmist and prophet at the place where his feet stood in Psalm 132, where his all-embracing hands were outspread and his life-giving body was stretched out for our sake. As we reverence and greet the cross with faith, let us draw and keep the abundant holiness flowing from it. Then in the sublime and glorious future advent of our Lord and God and Savior Jesus Christ, as we see him come in glory, we shall rejoice and skip for joy unceasingly, having attained to a place on his right hand, and heard the promised joyful words and blessing to the glory of the Son of God crucified in the flesh for us. For to him belongs all glory, together with his Father without beginning, and all holy good and life-giving Spirit. The cross is placed also in the middle of Great Lent. This is the middle, midpoint. To show us that the cross needs to be the central point of our life, the central part, pivotal point of our lives. Nothing else. It is the cross. As St. Paul says, in the cross I will boast, and nothing else. But how do we know? How do we know how to walk that cross? How to lift up that cross? How to deny ourselves? As Jesus says in today's gospel, whoever wants to follow me, in other words, whoever wants to walk my steps, walk my steps. I always hear this from the fathers, especially my as spiritual counsel to me. Walk in the footsteps, walk in the path, in the road of Christ. And I always ask the same question. Well, how do I know that road? How do I know that road? How do I know the road that Christ walks? How do I know the road that he wants? You know, I want to walk it. I want to walk it if I knew it. But how do I know it? And this is the answer. And he gives it. He's given it. If anyone wants to come after me, meaning to walk my steps, if anyone wants to come, walk my steps, let him deny himself first. Then pick up his cross and follow me. It's a great mystery. As St. Paul says, it's foolishness to the Greeks who seek signs and wonders. But to us who are called, this is the way, and this is the path, and this is the victory. Denying ourselves, we know. The Church, in its tradition, teaches first to deny ourselves from food. Basic things like infants, the Church is teaching us, like we're little kids, to deny ourselves from food. That's a denial. It's a denial. And whoever doesn't think it's a denial, he hasn't practiced fasting. It's a really big denial. But doesn't stop there, deny yourself from food. It's just one step, like lifting 20 pounds, now go to 40 pounds or 50 pounds. You know, deny yourself the pleasure of the evil thoughts that come. Deny them. Deny yourself to say a bad word to someone. Deny yourself the pleasure of hurting back someone who hurt you. Yeah? There's an urge. Well, you said this to me, now look at what I'm going to say. You did this to me, now look at what I can do. Right? Deny yourself. We know one or two things about denial, and we should practice it. then pick up your cross, he says, and pick up your cross every day and follow me. Yeah? That's the path. May the Lord help us walk.
So Father, and coming again with glory to judge the living and the dead, his kingdom shall have no end. And in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who together with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets, in one holy Catholic and apostolic church, I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the age to come. Amen.
Oh.
Sinners, of whom I am the first. I also believe that this is your sacred body, and this is Nephi confessed, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
Oh,
no.
Let us for a perfect holy peace, when sinners then let us commit ourselves and one another in our whole life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord.
We give thanks to you, Master who has been kind, that benefactor of our souls, that even on this very day, you have made us worthy of your heavenly immortal mystery. You make straight our path, pour twice your dear God, and I make secure our steps. Prepare the supplication for you, the focus and the Virgin Mary, and of all the saints. O Tisio, Yasmo, Simon, Kesin, Nox, and a fellow man, O Patrick, to you, to your family, and in India, eis to seu nas to neu.
Amen.
Let us go forth in peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, who blesses those who bless you, makes holy those who put their trust in you. Save your people and bless your inheritance. Protect the whole body of your church. Make holy those who love the beauty of your house, glorify them in return by your divine power. Forsake us not, forsake our hope in you. Grant peace to your world, to the churches, to the clergy, to the leaders, to our forces, for your people. For every good and perfect gift is from above, coming out from you, the Father of lights. To you give glory, thanksgiving, and worship. To the Father, and to the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and ever, to the ages of ages.
Amen. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, from this time forth unto the ages. Blessed be the name of the Lord, from this time forth unto the ages.
Session with the cross that is placed in the middle of the tray. We're going to go around, we'll place the tray in the middle, in the center. We'll chant a little bit out of the cross. Thank you. Spiritum, of Trimitus, the wonder worker, were father among the saints, John, Christopher, Archbishop of Constantinople, the holy and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, and of all the saints whose memory we keep today, have mercy on us and save us, for your good and love mankind. Through the prayers of our holy fathers, for Jesus Christ and God, have mercy on us and save us.
Amen.
We'll take the antiderol, and as you come to receive the antiderol, the blessed bread, please also take one flower with you as as a reminder of today's feast and vocation of the cross. And remember the cross, the center of our life.
Son,